Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series of lessons is for the months of October, November, and December of 2016. It's a very interesting series on the Book of Job. I don't know how long it's been since you've read the Book of Job. I hope you've done it recently. This particular lesson is lesson number 4 for October 22 of 2016, entitled God and Human Suffering. That should be an interesting subject. Before we begin, we'd like to encourage you to get your Bible if you don't have it handy and pray with us. Our kind and wonderful Father, we consider it a great blessing to have your words spread out before us in a language we can understand in the Holy Scriptures. We think now about Job and his experiences that happened so many years ago, some 4,000 years ago probably. It's hard for us to even comprehend what he went through. But help us to understand it and what you intended to teach us from it is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a few, we try to slip in a little bit of information about the Book of Job and each one of these lessons until we've sort of covered the field. And I quote from our Bible study guide, "Unlike every other book of the Bible, the Book of Job is completely removed from the context of the land and people of Israel. From Genesis with the promise to Abram that the Lord will make of thee a great nation, Genesis 12:2, to Revelation, which describes the holy city Jerusalem, in some way, directly or indirectly, the context of Israel and its covenant relationship with God help shape each book. In Job, there is nothing of that, not even the seminal event in ancient Israelite history, the Exodus. Nothing about the Exodus in the Book of Job. The most immediate reason is that Moses wrote Job in Midian, along with Genesis, and there's a comment about that in the SDA Bible Commentary. We'll look at what Ellen White says about that a little bit later. The Exodus had not yet happened, which explains why it's not mentioned. So why do you suppose that is? Job appears to have no relationship with the children of Israel. Did Moses meet Job or his family and learn about him while he was herding sheep in Midian? Okay, it's time for everybody to do their speculation. Guessing?
Surely sounds to be possible, doesn't it?
I think we tend to underestimate the numbers of people on the earth way back. I think there might have been more than we realize.
It sure doesn't sound like a fairy tale.
No.
I mean, it looks like it has real life, because the experiences that they're related by Eliphaz and his and the other three guys, sounds like the stuff you could hear from a pulpit today.
Yeah.
Wrong, but still from a pulpit.
It's very difficult today to locate the story of Job. I think we've mentioned already that it says he's a man from the east, which if you are a Jew, that generally means somewhere east of the Jordan River. Some people want to make him toward the north, which would make him in what might be southern Syria today. Some people want to put him in the south, which might be maybe even northwestern Saudi Arabia today, somewhere over there. But we are sure that Moses was the one who wrote the book down. Now, it may have taken place, the events themselves may have taken place maybe even hundreds of years before Moses. Some people want to date the story of Job and the fact that he probably was at least 70 years old by the time he had 10 kids. And he lived another 140 years, it says in Job 42. So here's a man who lived over 200 years, we're estimating, at least. He may have been more than that by the time he had 10 kids. So the land of Uz, we mentioned, we don't know where it is. It's found in Job 4, talks about it in Job 1:1. It's also mentioned in Lamentations 4, verse 21, where it says, if I can get my computer to work here properly. Laugh on, people of Edom and Uz. Be glad while you can. Your disaster is coming to you too will stagger naked in shame. So it's because of its association with Edom that some people think it might be in maybe northwestern Saudi Arabia today. The mining activities described in Job 28 seem to fit with what we know about the area around ancient Edom and the southern portion of modern Jordan. So either southern Jordan or maybe northern Saudi Arabia.
So Ken, if the book of Job has nothing to do with Israel or their ancestors, why is it in the Bible?
Yeah, I think the answer will be pretty clear by the time we get to the end of this lesson. At least the author is going to try to make it clear to us. There are those who believe that the story of Job is simply a literary wisdom composition and not a historical account. It is true that much of the book of Job was written in poetry, and it is highly literary. Other references in Scripture, including Ezekiel 14, 14 and 20, I want to just mention that. Look at these two verses. Even if those three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were living there, their goodness would save only their own lives, the sovereign Lord has spoken. That's Ezekiel 14, 14, and then 14, 20. Even if Noah, Daniel, and Job lived there, as surely as I, the sovereign Lord, am the living God, they would not be able to save even their own children. Their goodness would save only their own lives. So clearly, Ezekiel, if we believe he's operating under the inspiration of God, believed that Job was a real person and lived a real story and was a very righteous man. James 5:11, we call them happy because they endured. You have heard of Job's patience, and you know how the Lord provided for him in the end. So James, the stepbrother of Jesus, apparently believed that Job was real. So we're going to conclude in this class that, yes, Job was a real person, and these events really happened to him. Well, in any case, it is very clear that the issues addressed in Job include human suffering, and even more important, the issue of theodicy. Can we review again, what is theodicy?
Something to do with the righteousness of God.
Something to do with the righteousness of God. It has to do with the judgment of God, the truthfulness of God. Really, we might say, what kind of a person is God? Can he be trusted or not? We'll talk a lot about that before we end our study of the book of Job. There's another issue in the book of Job that we just sort of tangentially mentioned, but we're going to talk about it for a moment. Look at Romans. This is part of the theodicy issue. Book of Romans chapter 1, I'm going to start with verse 16. This is Paul speaking, of course. I have complete confidence in the gospel. Now, the King James says, I am not ashamed. But I think it's better to say, I have complete confidence in the gospel. It is God's power to save all who believe, first the Jews and also the Gentiles. For the gospel reveals how God puts people right with himself. It is through faith from beginning to end. As the scripture says, the person who is put right with God through faith shall live. Now, there's multiple ways to translate those two verses. They're very, very potent, very meaningful verses. But basically, it's Paul's attempt to introduce us to the story of the gospel. And how does he go on to discuss the gospel? God's anger is revealed from heaven against all the sin and evil of people whose evil ways prevent the truth from being known. God punishes them because what can be known about God is plain to them, for God himself made it plain ever since God created the world. His invisible qualities, both his eternal power and his divine nature, have been clearly seen. They are perceived in the things God has made. So these people have no excuse at all. Is that an airtight case? How do you feel about that? You feel like nature and our surroundings make it very clear that God is the creator and sustainer of the world?
Paul sure thinks so, didn't he?
Yeah.
And with his life experience he'd had up until that time, he was probably right.
Well, it's interesting from our perspective in discussing these things is that he chooses, the very first thing he chooses to talk about when he's talking about the gospel is God's character. He starts out with God's wrath, but that's a part of God's character. So, how often when we think about the gospel, does God's character come up first of all? Well, what do we think about when we think about the gospel?
Well, isn't it about God, the gospel?
Well, that's not what most people think of when you mention the gospel. To most people, gospel means, how is God going to save me?
Well, it's often coupled with kingdom. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. So, and then God, the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven, all of those associations there.
Yeah, but the character of the king will rule over the land. Mm-hmm. So
what about Christ's statement to the disciples, "You've seen me, you've seen the Father."
Mm-hmm.
That's the practical side of it.
Yeah. Well, if you pay any attention to the field of science and so forth, virtually every day there's some kind of new information about the marvels of life and the biology and physiology of all living creatures. Yet many of those who are doing this complex research at least claim publicly to believe that it all came about by chance. That just blows me away. What an irony. We know that even the individual cell is so incredibly complex that it could not have happened by chance. Think of some of the electronic marvels we deal with every day. I'm sitting here in front of a computer that has 4,500 books in it. And we look at some of them, different ones from time to time. When you look at this, do you think, well, I think that probably happened by chance? What would the same people who think we just happened by chance, what would they say if you, well, this computer probably happened by chance, what would they say to you? What's wrong with your thinking, friend? Right?
I don't know, though. For some reason, from appearances, something that's made from metal and things like that seems to be different than organic stuff. So,
why?
Well,
you don't think you look designed?
Well, I didn't say that. I was just saying that that there seems to be a difference between organic things and things that have been built or cut out like this, that kind of thing. But you're right, there you still have an extraordinary amount of organization, design, and things have to work just right or else it won't work. And it's kind of hard to believe.
Plus the ability to reproduce itself. Books can't, or computers can't reproduce themselves. You can do certain copy things, of course, but biological things are capable of reproduction and filling the earth as God gave the command.
But for all our marvelous science, we still don't know what life is.
Yeah.
The life force. We know it's there and we know we lose it. But what is it?
Well, there's those that will deny that, even in our...
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The reproducing part, though, could be just a lack of technology on our behalf.
Well, but what does that say to you? I mean, if it was easy to understand and easy to learn it, we would have discovered it a long time ago.
That's right.
So it means it's incredibly complicated. It's not an easy question. Mm-hmm. Well, Job said in Job 12, even birds and animals have much they could teach you. Ask the creatures of earth and see for their wisdom. All of them know that the Lord's hand made them. It is God who directs the lives of his creatures. Everyone's life is in his power. But just as your tongue enjoys tasting food, your ears enjoy hearing words. Old people have wisdom, but God has wisdom and power. Old people have insight. God has insight and power to act. That's a significant difference, isn't it?
Big difference.
Well, compare that with the words we read from Romans 1. So, what do you think? Are you convinced about the complexity of the cell, the complexity of human beings? Or do you think they might have just really happened by chance? I'm inclined to think that I don't care how many years you take.
Well, back in Darwin's day, they thought of the cell as pretty simple. You had a nucleus and
it was an
outer covering.
Bowl full of jelly.
Yeah, and that it just sort of could congeal from fat in the ocean or, chemicals and stuff. But now you go to medical school and you've got a book this thick and a whole course just on the cell by itself.
Yeah.
In a chemistry class back many years ago in college.
You don't know anything about many years ago.
Yeah. It was a professor went through some calculations on, you know, on how complex all the ends, some numerical calculations on this, how complex, you know, things were and the chance of this reproduction, you know, and, you know, the enzyme processes, even one, a couple enzymes, you have to have a bunch of enzymes. So it's just astronomical statistics.
Well, a professor that I know about did just a simple thing. He had a classroom, a whole bunch of students, and he said, okay, how many of you think this? Okay, we're going to say it was a chance of 1 out of 100. How many of you think this? Well, 10 out of 90. And, you know, he just started talking about the things that you'd have to do to produce life and so forth. And he just used his stats were just from the students in his class. I mean, you start multiplying those things out and pretty soon you're in the millions. One chance out of millions or billions.
You have the organism has to be able to reproduce at the same time that it has all the other processes that occur.
Yep.
And you know,
not only that, it has to try to protect itself, it has to try to heal itself, try to, oh man. Well, one of the issues involved with all this is the issue of special revelation versus general revelation. Can someone tell me what general revelation is?
Things like nature,
God
revealing himself through.
What you can learn from nature, from our surroundings, from even from behavior of other human beings to a certain extent. And what would be special revelation then?
God's revelation through prophets.
Okay. Down what God has chosen to reveal us to us, mainly through prophets, yeah.
So who made those two categories?
Theologians.
Theologians?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So what do you think is the relationship between special revelation and general revelation? Are they in conflict, or what do you think?
Well, I think we've already made mention, not tonight, but in other classes, there are those going to get to heaven that all they know about God is what they learned around them.
Yeah. And Paul goes on to say that, doesn't he, in Romans 1 and 2.
Yeah. God is the source in both cases.
Okay.
And he's the source of the information in what he's created, which is what, since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, mm-hmm. being understood through what has been made. So he's revealing things in a general way.
Yeah. How much can you learn from general revelation? A lot. Okay? Certainly we learn a lot of things about design. And I mean, you go to something like, we not too far from us here, we have the down by in Long Beach, the big marine place there. And the variety of animals and the different colors and the different patterns on those different colors, it just blows me away anyway. How would you even, you know, take some of the birds in East Africa where I used to live, which have, you know, 6 or 8 different colors and very distinct patterns on their bodies. How would you write that into the DNA? How would you do that?
Or maybe trial and error, they say.
Or maybe it's all there. It's all there, but certain ones are brought out at different times in their development.
Yeah. Well,
turned on.
There's a cosmological argument about God's existence. What's the cosmological argument? That's the argument that says things must have been, or things are relatively orderly. They must have been caused by something that led to that, and then you ask, okay, what led to that thing, and what led to that thing, and you go back and back and back and back. And of course, our evolutionary friends, what do they go back to?
The Big Bang.
The Big Bang. And so you ask them, well, where did the Big Bang come from? And they say, No idea.
A real answer.
Now, our Stephen Hawking kind of friends will say, well, it came out of nothing. Well, the laws of thermodynamics say you can't, nothing can come from nothing. Even some famous songs say that, don't they?
Which is why you ask the question, you know, the next thing. That's kind of the scientific process. But ultimately, you just end up with a trail onto infinity doing the same thing over and over. So ultimately, there has to be a cause, mm-hmm. an uncreated cause, one that was eternal and always there.
Of course, the atheists who want to be really skeptical will say, okay, so you go back to God, where did God come from? How would you respond to that?
Where did God come from?
Yeah. I mean, isn't that the logical question to ask if you're an atheist or an evolutionist?
Right, because it's the next, you know.
He always existed, but, you know, we don't understand those sorts of things.
But you have the same question if you just say it came from the Big Bang, as we've said. And not every scientist believes in the Big Bang. There are huge amounts of problems with the whole
setup. I have a friend that I love his thinking. He's a real, real, he's passed long ago now, but some incredible thinking. And he one time was having a big discussion. When he was young, I mean, he was in high school. And he had this big discussion with a professor from one of the big universities here on the West Coast. Just by accident, he was sitting next to him at a ball game. And they had discussed several times, because they traditionally came out and watched. They came out to watch soccer in the days when almost nobody had any interest in soccer. And so every Sunday afternoon, they'd be sitting there with just a few other spectators watching the soccer game. So this discussion had gone on. And so this one Sunday afternoon, the young kid, it's because they had gone back and forth and they didn't seem to be getting anywhere. And finally he said to the professor, he says, okay, I have a question for you. He says, we both know, neither one of us were there when things happened back in the beginning. Neither one of us was there in the beginning. And I think that God reports what happened in the beginning, but you don't believe that. So basically we're saying, we don't have any records from anybody who was there when it happened. So since we know nothing about that end of history, let's come to this end of history. Let's just assume for a moment that you're thinking about the survival of the fittest. Suppose that has been the rule of life from that day until this. Still, even today, it's survival of the fittest. If you're more powerful, you know, than somebody else, you can take what belongs to them, etc. That's the way that survival of the fittest works. And by contrast, let's say that God was there at the beginning, and he created Adam and Eve, and he created all of us who followed them as their children. He says, now, and we're supposed to be brothers and sisters and treat each other like members of the same family. He says, which one of those two societies would you rather live in? And the professor just hesitated for a moment, and he says, you got me.
Which brings us back to the character of God, because you could argue that an all-powerful God could have used evolution to do this, sure. You know, over millions of years of suffering and death, but would a God of love have done it that way?
Yeah.
Makes more sense to go to Genesis and see that as
And you source. Can't believe in evolution and believe in the Bible. You really can't, because if you... You know, the original sin is described in Genesis 3. It's suggested other parts of the Bible talk, that's the original sin. Well, we believe that the Bible says that sin leads to death. Well, those people who want to believe in evolution, they have lots and lots of deaths taking place before you even get to the first human. Did those animals, did those creatures, did those salamanders, did they sin? Why did they die? I don't think you can really believe in the Bible and evolution at the same time.
So, if animals died, that means they sinned.
Well, that's the question.
I mean, that's what you're
that's the question.
Saying
that's part
well,
of
well, is it
knowledge.
True? Do animals sin when they die?
Well, if you believe that sin is what leads to death, and that's, we believe, of course, believe that started with Adam and Eve.
The first death or the second death? Do animals have any other second death?
No, I'm not talking about the second death. I'm talking about the first death.
I think it's talking about the second death.
When we say
all the time.
No, it can't be, because God said to Adam and Eve, you will die, and they certainly didn't die, and they never will die the second
death. You don't know for sure if that's the death he was talking about.
Well,
you're just making that, you're just putting that together. But as soon as everything gets put together, then we'll find out.
Okay.
The original sin was not with Adam and Eve.
No,
we got the war in heaven that we don't find out until we get to the end of the
book.
But the original sin was not with salamanders either.
That's true.
Or dinosaurs.
That's right.
But they everybody suffers because of the choices made there.
Yes,
we now have a world where we have knowledge of good and evil, and so you have innocent animals dying as well.
Well, there's
people who choose evil things.
Yeah. I think you could tie in what we've known about Dr. Niece. Mm-hmm. You can't prove creation, you can't prove evolution. It's the life you lead, and in one sense it's a kind of a gamble, but if you lead the good life and believe in salvation and the great controversy, you've got a chance of a life hereafter. Yeah. The opposite side, they're done.
Yeah. Well, there are a number of verses. We have just a few of them mentioned here. Revelation 4:11, Colossians 1:16 and 17, John 1:1-3, and Hebrews 1:1-3, that tell us just in so many words that God created everything. So if you don't like my argument from Scripture, you can just take the forthright words of God. Those who are aware of some of what is going on in the scientific world have probably heard of Stephen Hawking. He is considered to be one of the greatest scientists of modern times. On one occasion he wrote, because there is a law like gravity, the universe can and will create itself from nothing.
Well, then you could ask, where did the law of gravity come from?
Yeah, exactly.
Where do these laws come from?
That's in his book, The Grand Design. Anyway. Is it possible for rational human beings really to believe that the universe came into existence from nothing? Paul suggested that that kind of idea is foolishness.
They still can rationalize, you know.
What are you thinking about when you say nothing?
Nothing.
Don't understand.
I mean, really nothing. The Big Bang people, the hardcore Big Bang people believe that suddenly, just out of nothing, this Big Bang sort of, and in a billionth of a second, it just, and the whole universe has come out of it.
Well, where did God get his material then from?
We got to get to heaven to find out.
Yeah, no.
That's not a good answer.
It's the right answer. I'm going to answer that question for you.
Okay.
The answer is this. We know that there's a relationship between energy and matter. E equals mc squared. That's the relationship.
Okay.
The famous equation. Okay. God has all the energy in the universe.
So
he compresses his energy and makes mass out of it. I don't think that's a problem.
Are you sure there was energy even back then? Maybe he brought energy.
If God controls the entire universe, he has energy, let me assure you.
Well, he has energy, but how about before everything started? Because there was a time when there was nothing.
You think God has changed? I don't think so.
No. That is my question.
We surmise that, but we really don't know.
Yeah, I would question that, because if he takes his energy and turns it into matter, then you have a case for pantheism.
Why would you say that?
Because inherently the energy is, if the energy is part of his being, then we become part of his being in the same way.
In a way.
Energy's never lost. It can be.
I think there's a point with what he's saying there. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. God can bring things out of nothing. So we can't really razz all these scientists for thinking things come out from nothing. How do they know? Maybe they just don't have God in the equation there to make it happen.
Yeah. Well, let's turn to the specific question raised in this lesson, and that's the question of human suffering. So all this is supposed to be a background for us to talk about human suffering. If, and here's the big question, if God is all good, all loving, all powerful, and if you believe that He created everything, which I do, how could evil exist? Was God responsible for making evil? Did He create it?
Choice. God is love, and to have love, you have to have a choice.
Well, so He created the setting in which evil came out of.
Okay. It is my personal belief that it is impossible to explain the existence of evil rationally without an understanding of the great controversy over God's character and government, and as Jib mentioned, love and what's required, the freedom that's necessary if you're going to have love and freedom of choice. To explain the existence of evil would be the equivalent of excusing it. Ellen White said these incredible words, I think she that could hardly be said better, in Great Controversy, pages 492 and 493, and I quote, "It is impossible to explain the origin of sin so as to give a reason for its existence. Yet enough may be understood concerning both the origin and the final disposition of sin to make fully manifest the justice and benevolence of God and all His dealings with evil. Nothing is more plainly taught in Scripture than that God was in no wise responsible for the entrance of sin, that there was no arbitrary withdrawal of divine grace, no deficiency in the divine government that gave occasion for the uprising of rebellion.
If it's true, though, that there's no rational explanation for sin, how do you come up with a rational explanation that it didn't have anything to do with God?
Well, I mean, that comes out of your understanding of the Great Controversy. If I give you freedom and you make a bad choice, am I responsible? Because, let's use the real example.
Bad choice?
Well, let's give the original argument. God created love. You can't have real love unless you have the ability to hate. You have to have freedom in order to have love. Otherwise, you're just a robot. So God made us capable of doing that. He made the angels capable of loving and hating. For whatever reason...
You can only go to the love side or else you get killed.
Well,
you don't get killed.
You just destroy yourself.
Or you're destroyed by another one that is person or being that is self-centered.
Yeah.
Self-centeredness is destructive. Yeah. God is the source of life. He doesn't have to kill any creature.
You know, you're getting pretty close to rationalization here, and sin can't be explained by rationalization.
Well, that's what she's trying to say there. Yeah. If you could find a reason for it, there wouldn't be an excuse for it. It wouldn't be sin.
I know, but my point I'm making is that you are coming up with a rationale for it.
Okay, we need to keep moving on.
I think it's in conflict with what we were reading.
Sin is an intruder for whose presence no reason can be given. It is mysterious, unaccountable. To excuse it is to defend it. Could excuse for it be found or cause be shown for its existence, it would cease to be sin. Our only definition of sin is that given in the Word of God, it is a transgression of the law. 1 John 3:4.
Or lawlessness, another translation.
Lawlessness, rebelliousness. So it is the outworking.
There's no reason for anybody to choose the wrong way if that's sin, right?
Well, ultimately, yeah. We do it because we're so accustomed to it, and so it's ingrained in us, and so habit-forming. We do it, not because it was the right thing to do.
Well, I think it's sin cannot be explained because it's not rational. It comes from the heart, which isn't rational.
Absolutely. We're not arguing with that at all.
That's the point there, is that.
But that's, yeah, you can't.
That's
not an
excuse. Emotions come up, it doesn't. Yeah. Emotions come up with that rationale.
Yeah.
And sin comes from that very same area.
She goes on to say, it is the outworking of a principle at war with the great law of love, which is the foundation of the divine government. Great Controversy 492, 43. So where did the book of Job and the story of Job come from? We suggested earlier that there's evidence that Moses wrote it. Here's what Ellen White says in in Signs of the Times, February 19, 1880, paragraph 14. It's also in the SDA Bible Commentary, volume 3, page 1140, paragraph 3. The long years spent amid desert solitudes were not lost. Not only was Moses gaining a preparation for the great work before him, but during this time, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he wrote the book of Genesis and also the book of Job, which would be read with the deepest interest by the people of God until the close of time. Most commentators agree that it is difficult to pinpoint the time. This is now quoting from our adult teacher's Bible study guide. Most commentators agree that it is difficult to pinpoint the time and place that the book of Job took place or was written. Ellen G. White mentions that Moses wrote the book of Job during his sojourn in Midian, sometime between 1490 and 1450 BC, before the Exodus from Egypt took place. Rabbinic tradition in the Talmud also suggests Moses as the author. And that's in Tractate Baba Batra 14b, so I thought we would look it up and look what it actually says. There's a section like this, but the top of the section is, who wrote them? Just those words, who wrote them? And it's a section describing the books of the Bible. And it says under that section B, Moses wrote his own book and part of Balaam and Job. And there's, you know, the comments about from Balaam that are recorded in the book of Numbers that some people regard as a book written by Balaam. So if Job was one of the first two books to be written, why was that?
I think it would, one explanation that it was to be a prism or a lens with which to read the rest of the teachings that would come down to him, because it has most every element you need there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting that Moses was writing probably just about the time the first alphabets were invented, just shortly after the first. Yes,
it's interesting that early in Genesis, we hear about the great controversy, very much in the Garden of Eden, and early in Job, and at the end of Job, we hear a lot about the great controversy.
Yep.
Those were the first two books written. You know, as you say, there's the setting for the whole rest of the Bible.
Did God have an idea of what was coming when he made that arrangement?
Of course.
Well, if you read places like Matthew, well, let's just look at a couple of these verses. Matthew 6, verse 34. So do not worry about tomorrow. It will have enough worries of its own. There's no need to add to the troubles each day brings. And look at, for example, Matthew 24, verse 7. Countries will fight each other. Kingdoms will attack one another. There will be famines and earthquakes everywhere. All these things are like the first pains of childbirth, including verse 8 there. What can we learn from these passages? Does it tell us anything about the growth of evil? Yes.
Yeah, bad things will happen. And as things begin to randomly dissociate, more and more chaos ensues.
Does it look around, as you look around you, does it seem like the world is getting better and better?
Anything but.
Anything but.
My observation here about with the book of Job, we have the first two chapters, gives us an insight as to who's bringing these calamities on Job, right? Mm-hmm. But then you go to chapter 2, it says, the fire from God fell from heaven and burned upon the sheep and the servants and consumed them. Now it's implied that God was involved. But and also you go to chapter 42, verse 11, it says, his brothers and sisters brought this stuff because of all the harm that was brought upon Job.
Yeah. Well, That brought God on Job.
But I go hark back to about a year ago when Gordon pointed out, and we pointed out in time past, if you have one God concept, you attribute everything to that God. Mm-hmm. That's a key thing we need, because that should be the prism or this lens with which we read the rest of the Bible. Well, until we get to the Gospels. Mm-hmm. There's nothing in the Gospels where Jesus referred to this, look what I did with Job. I took away my protection from Job. It's not there, and it's not there. Let's go back and study Joshua and Judges. Jesus didn't refer to any of that. And if God never changes, Malachi 3:6 and so forth, anyway, I'm thankful for the opportunity to go through this book of Job.
Yeah.
Also, I would mention that paragraph that you had from Great Controversy, chapter 29, probably one of the most important chapters of any book a person could read. If they don't do that, they're at a loss.
Did Job ever question the existence of God?
No.
Why not?
Because he talked to him, seemingly.
Yeah.
Had personal communication.
His in the book, if you read it through, and you probably need to read it through several times to really sort of get the feel, his question was not, does God exist? His question is, what kind of a person is God? What kind of person would do this to me or even allow all this to happen to me? Have you ever had that kind of questions in your mind? Look at Job 6, 4 to 8, just for example. Almighty God has pierced me with arrows, and their poison spreads through my body. God has lined up his terrors against me. A donkey is content when eating grass, and a cow is quiet when eating hay. But who can eat tasteless, unsalted food? What flavor is there in the white of an egg? I have no appetite for food like that, and everything I eat makes me sick. Why won't God give me what I ask? What does he want? Why won't he answer my prayer? So what we're saying here is Job's biggest worry, his biggest concern is, why isn't God responding to me? Well, if you were to ask an atheist or an evolutionist to explain why there's evil in the world, what kind of answer might you get?
Well, they might question whether there is such a thing as good and evil. There is only the desire to reproduce and to survive. Mm. So in the context of that,
So good would be the ability to reproduce better, faster, or
whatever? Well, there would, I don't know if they would use the terms good and evil. They would, particularly if they that started drawing the thoughts closer to somebody like God. You know, and why is there good? We could ask the same question: where does all this goodness come from? If there's only the desire to survive.
Well, another aspect of this, we've mentioned just briefly in passing, Job 10, 8 to 12. I think we have a moment to probably look at that. Your hands formed and shaped me, and now those same hands destroy me. Remember that you made me from clay. Are you going to crush me back to dust? You gave my father strength to beget me. You made me grow in my mother's womb. You formed my body with bones and sinews and covered the bones with muscles and skin. You have given me life and constant love, and your care has kept me alive. So, and basically, you know, why do you want to destroy me now? If we lived in a world that was mechanically controlled by cause and effect, then evil should only happen to people who are sinners or who bring the evil upon themselves. But we see that, as in the case of Job, bad things happen to good people, even to good people who are nonetheless sinners. Is all of that just pure chance? Or are we seeing demonstrated the fact that sin has terrible consequences not only for the sinner directly himself, but also for others around him?
John the Baptist and Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Look at Deuteronomy 29, verse 19 as a possibility. Make sure that there is no one here today. This is Moses giving his final instructions to the children of Israel. Make sure there is no one here today who hears these solemn demands and yet convinces himself that all will be well with him, even if he stubbornly goes his own way. That would destroy all of you, good and evil alike. What's implied by that? Deuteronomy 29:19.
Each of us have turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So when we turn from God, we're turning from life. We're turning to what we think is a good way. But
we have no landmark without God.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the big thing right there. Without God, you're lost. You're floating to who knows where.
Well, it's very interesting that you say that, Gary, because our lesson turns next to Romans chapter 3, the first four verses. And I'm going to read those now. If you remember well, Romans starts out briefly with an introduction. Then Paul jumps immediately into discussing the gospel, and he says how evil the pagans were before they found Christianity. Then he moves to chapter 2, and he says, and you people who used to be Jews were even worse. And in chapter 3, he says, now let's conclude. What are we going to conclude? And here's his words. Have the Jews then any advantage over the Gentiles? Or is there any value in being circumcised? Of course, circumcision was the mark of the Jew in those days. Much indeed in every way. In the first place, God trusted his message to the Jews. Virtually all of Scripture came to us from Jews. Okay? The whole story. But what if some of them were not faithful? Does this mean that God will not be faithful? Certainly not. God must be true even though every human being is a liar. As the scripture says, you, talking about God, you must be shown to be right when you speak. You must win your case when you are being tried. God is on trial? How could that be? I mean, God is sovereign. Who could question about anything about him?
People judge God every day by their, and they make a choice either for him, that is to listen and take instructions, or to go their own self-centered way. It's a judgment.
Yeah, yeah. And that's what the great controversy is about.
Sadly, if you went to the NIV and read that chapter, verse 4, it says, may you make the right judgment. Mm-hmm. Just they flip it on its head. The NIV has messed it up there.
Well, if God exists, what kind of a person is he? Can he be trusted? Is he responsible for the evil that exists in our world? And once again, I would turn to Ellen White, and where she says this is found in Great Controversy 670 and 671. Every question of truth and error in the longstanding controversy has now been made plain. She's talking about the very end. The results of rebellion, the fruits of setting aside the divine statutes, have been laid open to the view of all created intelligences. The working out of Satan's rule, in contrast with the government of God, has been presented to the whole universe. Satan's own works have condemned him. God's wisdom, his justice, his goodness, stands fully vindicated. It is seen that all his dealings in the great controversy have been conducted with respect to the eternal good of his people and the good of all the worlds that he has created. So how could all the evil, the existence of all this evil, be for the good of God and his people?
People will ultimately make a choice and recognize their choice for eternity.
And the evil and its consequences will be obvious, good and its consequences will be obvious. And everyone will say, God, you did it right.
And ask a question. Who's keeping evil going?
God.
Most people would say Satan or people or so forth. It's God. Because if sin is separation from God, what can live separated from the source of life?
And God is the only source of life.
Yeah.
Well, all thy works shall bless thee, Psalm 145, verse 10. The history of sin will stand to all eternity as a witness that with the existence of God's law is bound up the happiness of all the beings he has created. With all the facts of the great controversy in view, the whole universe, both loyal and rebellious, with one accord declare, just and true are thy ways, thou King of Saints, Revelation 15:3. And that's those words are made, stated right in the middle of the seven last plagues.
And they came to that conclusion not through fear, intimidation, or extortion, it's rational. They've said all the evidence, and it adds up and computes for them.
They see God, they see what he's done, they see what the consequences are. They look at the devil, they see what he's done, and they see the consequences. And now as they see those two forces winding up and coming to conclusion, they're saying, amen, let's get it over with, right? Do you believe that the whole great controversy is over? That when the whole great controversy is over, we will be able to look back at the events and praise God for what he has done?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Incredible as it may seem, the angels in heaven will be rejoicing even in the midst of the seven last plagues. Not rejoicing about the plagues, but rejoicing because evil is revealing its hand. The devil is showing his hand, the final everything, and this, okay, the evidence is spread out on the table now.
It's exposed for what it is.
Yeah. Do we really believe that everything God does and what he asks of us is for our best good, as he claims? If so, shouldn't we thank him now, even in our ignorance of why some things are happening? C.S. Lewis, famous Christian apologist, wrote a book after his wife died in which he stated, "Not that I am, I think, in much danger of ceasing to believe in God. The real danger, I wonder what would happen if C.S. Lewis could talk to Stephen Hawking. Yeah. The real danger is of coming to believe such dreadful things about him. The conclusion, now this is, remember, in the context of the Second World War, the conclusion I dread is not, so there's no God at all, but, so this is what God's really like. Deceive yourself no longer." Wow. How does that hit you? What are the most important things that God has done to teach us about his character? Wouldn't it have to be the life, ministry, and death of Jesus?
Yeah, definitely.
Well, if you had the opportunity to speak to an evolutionist or an atheist, what would you say to them, to him or her, to convince him or her that life is not just meaningless? Could you produce some kind of convincing evidence that there is life beyond this life? What evidence could we provide that God can be trusted and interacts with human beings on a regular basis? Could we provide that kind of evidence?
Well, by reflecting his character, being trustworthy and loving and kind, because that's something they can't refute.
It's interesting that Isaiah takes up that question in his book, in chapters 55 to 65, and I can't begin to summarize it in just so many words, but in just a few words. Basically, he says there's two reasons why you must believe that there's a real God, and he's the kind of God we believe he is, and he's not just like the pagan gods. Number one is his ability to create. But number two is his ability to predict the future far in advance. And that can be absolutely documented. And there's no other way to explain it. There's no evolutionary way, no atheistic way of explaining the fact that God repeatedly predicts things far in advance. The coming of Jesus, and I mean, we could go on and on. Many, many predictions in the Bible, hundreds of years in advance. How can evolution ever explain something like that? Not a chance. Well, what about the flowers? And many of them have a wonderful aroma. Did God have to make flowers with a wonderful aroma? What does that say about God's love? The balance we see in nature, you know, we breathe in oxygen, we breathe out carbon dioxide, and the plants, they breathe in carbon dioxide and breathe out oxygen. I mean, beautiful balance, right?
But then if you cut all the trees down, like they've been doing for some time, and then they want to strangle people because of carbon dioxide.
Yeah. That's
carbon dioxide is plant food.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. We know that there has been suffering since the days of Adam and Eve, when Cain killed his brother Abel, extending all the way down to our day. And we have scriptural evidence that the things will only get worse. Have you worked things out well enough so that you are comfortable with that progression and you understand why it is happening? Or are you still throwing secret accusations in God's direction? Well, here's a thought that gives us some pause. It's in page 53 of the Teacher's Sabbath School Bible Study Guide. The trunk lid fell with cruel finality. I could still see the light-colored pine coffin through the rear window, but then the undertaker started an engine and drove off. Gone. My child is gone. My glasses misted up from the tears. It hurt so much, as if I had been cut in half. even though I had known for months that this moment would eventually come, even though I had nodded when the undertaker asked, may I close the coffin now? Even though my mind had long ago agreed with Andrea's prayer, when Andrea prayed, Lord, let me go, let me die, I cannot fight anymore. Even though I was relieved that she no longer needed to suffer pain and never again had to fear another test result, my heart cried, no, it's so unfair, she's still so young, I wish I could have died in her place. Andrea had been only 25 years old when her struggle with cancer ended. So what does God have to say about that kind of a story? I can remember when my father passed away about a year and a half, and we were standing there watching him, and you know, you say, take another breath. Take another breath. Please, take another breath. I mean, what do you do? Well, any of us who've lived in this world long enough have been touched by suffering or even death. Have you ever felt that you were experiencing what Job talked about in Job 6, 4 to 10? Like the devil's arrows, the poisonous arrows are shooting at you? David was happy that God was fighting on his side in lots of battles. And I'm sure David, when he went out to battle, he would pray and there was no question in his mind that God was fighting on his side. I wonder how he felt about, he must have heard the story of Job. Did he ever think that God was shooting arrows at him? Since we believe that we will one day live in a perfect world where there's no pain, no death, no suffering, why do we have to go through a time of trouble before we get there? Does that make any sense? In conclusion, let us state emphatically once again that Satan's attacks on Job were really an attack on God's character and his ability to judge correctly. This is the basic issue in the great controversy. As we will discover, God himself spoke out at the end of the book. We'll get to that later. Our Bible study guide suggests that the purpose of this book was to vindicate Job. But was it Job that needed to be vindicated? Or did Job, by remaining faithful to God, help to vindicate God? Even in this lesson, it is to be noted that almost all of the questions were really about God. As we will see as we go along, the book is primarily about God. So what's your vote going to be in the great controversy? Are you going to vote for God or are you going to vote for the devil? You don't really have to vote for God. I mean, you don't really have to vote for the devil. You just have to refuse to vote for God. Our kind and wonderful Father, as we look at the challenging ideas that we have just seen in the book of Job about human suffering and about the evil in the world and why it exists, help us to have a clear picture that you are in no wise responsible in any way for all of that, but rather it's an enemy that hath done this. Help us to make the right choices as we consider the great controversy, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.